Morning. Welcome to worship this morning, those of you who are here in person and those watching us on live stream. Especially warm welcome if you're here for the first time. We hope you feel God's love here and our love as well. A reminder that our restrooms are down the hall and to my right. Our exits are the door at the back of the sanctuary and also a door here down the connecting hallway. And I want to remind everybody to please turn off your mobile devices. And refreshments and fellowship will be served in the courtyard today, so please come out for that after the service. We have a date for family camping. Are you going to say something? All right. Come on up, Allison. Do you want the microphone? Or?
Our family camping is back this year. The date is September 15th, and it's an all-ages event, a screens-off event to raise awareness and money for ShelterBox, which is an organization that provides emergency shelter all around the globe. So it will be sending boxes, I'm sure, to Hawaii. It provides shelter now in Ukraine and all over the world where shelter is needed on an emergency basis. So we're going to try to raise $1,000. We did, the last time we did this, we raised $1,000 to provide one box for shelter for one family in a disaster-torn area. It's an event for our community, though, to provide fun and fellowship. It's all ages event. If you do not want to spend the night on our lawn in your tent, you can you can come and spend at least a portion of the evening. There'll be games, telescopes, s'mores, snacks, lots of fun and fellowship around the campfire and with laughter and music and fun with your church family. It'll be the kickoff to our fellowship together this year. So we hope all of you can come. It should be a fun event. The other thing is our Sunday school will begin on September 10th. September 10th, I believe, right? Mm-hmm. We will be needing everybody's help. It's a very ambitious year this year. We'll need all of you to kind of open up your hearts, and if you're so inclined and you want to teach Sunday school, our rotation model requires two to three Sundays a month. You teach one Sunday school class, and you teach that class for that same class for the month, two or three times during the month, and you can exercise your ability to teach art or tell stories or whatever your particular gifts are. You can come and spend that time with our children. It's a very fun-filled time, and it takes a small commitment on your part, and it means a lot to our children, and it also means a lot to those that have taught before. They can tell you it's a wonderful experience, a small commitment on your part, and if you feel so inclined, talk to me, talk to Jenna. We'd love to have you join our team, and we're very excited about the new year and what September will bring us. So if you're so inclined, we're going to need all your help and all of your prayers as we begin our new year. So two very exciting things. We hope you can join us.
Thank you, Allison. There are a few more announcements in your bulletin, so make sure you check those out. Today we welcome to our pulpit Mary Scalzi, our own Mary Scalzi. Mary's been a member of Clarence Press for more than 25 years. That's it? It was longer than that. Last year, she retired from a 30-year career as a public middle school teacher. For the past 3 years, Mary's been working through an 8-course Christian leadership program online through Dubuque University Seminary, which she will complete this fall and will become a commission ruling elder in the Presbyterian Church USA. She and her family have participated in many, many ways in the life of this church over many years, many mission trips, canoe trips, Sunday school, session member, and so on. In February, Mary traveled for the third time to Kakamega, Kenya, to visit United Kenya Rising, an organization our church mission supports. So Mary, it's great to have you here today.
Good morning. I know if I lose my way, I'm among friends, and you will help me get there. So, please join me in our call to worship this morning. God has shown us, everyone, what is good. And what does the Lord require of us? Surely the Lord is in this place. Join us in hymn number 267.
Thank you.
Join me in prayer. We worship you this morning, Lord, and we give you thanks for this day. We love you. We know you are in this place. May your Holy Spirit make our worship today joyful and true. Amen. Friends, God promises us that if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive our sins. Let us confess our sins together, first together and then silently in our own ways. Almighty God, in raising Jesus from the grave, you shattered the power of sin and death. We confess that we remain captive to doubt and fear, bound by the ways that lead to death. We overlook the poor and the hungry, and pass by those who mourn. We are dead to the cries of the oppressed and indifferent to calls for peace. We despise the weak and abuse the earth you made. Forgive us, God of mercy. Help us to trust your power to change our lives and make us new, that we may know the joy of the abundant life given in Jesus Christ. Amen. As the east is from the west, so far does God take our transgressions from us. Believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Since God has forgiven us in Christ Jesus, let us forgive one another. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Please greet each other with a sign of peace.
I'd like to invite the children to come forward for the children's service or sermon. Excuse me. All right. I know for a couple weeks there in a row we had talked about the mustard seed. I'm not talking about the mustard seed, but I just want you to see what mustard seed looks like when it grows. There is a field out by me that had been plowed about a month ago, so all this mustard seed is in the field, so you can see what it kind of looks like. So, how many of you this morning play a musical instrument? How many of you sing? I think you all probably sing, right? Okay. What? Okay, I'm going to hear how you can sing. Okay, so when I was your age, I was in Sunday school here, and my mother played the piano for many, many years. So I remember a song that I'm going to teach you that you probably haven't heard before. I don't know if it was one that my mother kind of adapted or how it went, but some of us in the church know it. I'm going to sing, good morning to you, good morning to you. Good morning, everybody. Good morning to you. Okay, now I want you to sing that back, and I want the congregation to try, too. Ready? Good morning to you. Good morning to you. Good morning, everybody. Good morning to you. Okay, now there should be some familiarity to that song. What song is that? Have you ever heard that song before? Congregation, what's the song? Happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you, okay? So there was another one then that followed that. This would be our two songs we sang before we sang, got into our other songs. And that was, it's fun to go to church, it's fun to go to church with all the other boys and girls. It's fun to go to church. Okay, let's try singing that. Congregation two. It's fun to go to church, it's fun to go to church with all the other boys and girls. It's fun to go to church. Okay, now, how many of you are familiar with that tune? Do you know what the name of that tune really is? Farmer in the Dell. Excellent. Okay. So I know some people may not even have heard that tune before, but we had a lot of fun in Sunday school by singing familiar songs like that. So music is very important to us, and with Mary Scalzi here, she also was in that room with my mother playing the piano many years ago when I was helping in that room as an adult, and Mary Scalzi taught us a beautiful little song that you will probably sing for the rest of the day because it's the last song we're going to sing in the children's sermon. The song goes like this. Oh, Lord, I thank you. Oh, Lord, I thank you. I will thank you all the days of my life. You want to try that? Congregation two. Oh, Lord, I thank you. Oh, Lord, I thank you. I will thank you all the days of my life. And then Mary also taught us to put in different words, like we will say love you. Ready? Try to say that. Oh, Lord, I love you. Oh, Lord, I love you. I will love you all the days of my life. So those are some simple, silly Sunday school songs that I remember. Okay, and it's important to remember how important music is to us, especially in church. This is like Music Sunday today. There's a lot of music going on here today, and you're always a big part of it. So let's get in our freeform shape. I'm so glad we didn't have to have Miss Sue come up here. You showed a lot of enthusiasm today. But she's in the back there. Okay, let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you for bringing music into our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You can go with Miss Amanda to Junior Church if you're in that group, or back to your seats if you're a little older. Thanks for listening today.
Everything turn, turn, turn. There is a season, turn, turn, turn. And a time to every purpose under heaven. Time to be born, a time to die. A time to plant, a time to reap, a time to kill, a time to heal, a time to laugh, a time to weep. To everything turn. turn, 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 and a time for every purpose under heaven. Down, a time to dance, a time to mourn, a time to cast away stones, a time to gather stones together. To everything, turn, turn. There is a season, turn, 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 and a time for every purpose under heaven. A time of love, a time of hate, a time of war, a time of peace, a time you may embrace, a time to refrain from embracing. To everything, turn, 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 there is a season, turn, 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 and a time for every purpose under heaven. A time to gain, a time to lose, a time to rent, a time to sow. A time for love, a time for hate, a time for peace, I swear it's not too late. To everything, turn, 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 there is a season, turn, turn, turn. And a time for every purpose under heaven. And a time for every purpose under heaven.
Let us pray for illumination of the Word. Our Old Testament lesson for today comes from the book of Genesis, chapter 45, verses 1 through 15. It can be found in the Pew Bible on page 40. Then Joseph could no longer control himself before all who stood by him, and he cried out, "Send everyone away from me." So no one stayed with him when Joseph made himself known to his brothers. And he wept so loudly that the Egyptians heard it and the household of Pharaoh heard it. Joseph said to his brothers, "I am Joseph. Is my father still alive?" But his brothers could not answer him, so dismayed were they at his presence. Then Joseph said to his brothers, "Come closer to me." And they came closer. He said, "I am your brother Joseph, whom you sold into Egypt. And now do not be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here, for God sent me before you to preserve life. For the famine has been in this land these 2 years, and there are 5 more years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvest. God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to keep alive for you many survivors. So it was not you who sent me here, but God. He has made me a father to Pharaoh and Lord of all his house and ruler over all the land of Egypt. Hurry and go up to my father and say to him, thus says your son Joseph, God has made me Lord of all Egypt. Come down to me, do not delay. You shall settle in the land of Goshen, and you shall be near me, you and your children and your children's children, as well as your flocks, your herds, and all that you have. I will provide for you there, since there are 5 more years of famine to come, so that you and your household and all that you have will not come to poverty. And now your eyes and the eyes of my brother Benjamin see that it is my own mouth that speaks to you. You must tell my father how greatly I am honored in Egypt and all that you have seen. Hurry and bring my father down here. Then he fell upon his brother Benjamin's neck and wept, and Benjamin wept upon his neck. And he kissed all his brothers and wept upon them, and after that his brothers talked with him. Our psalm for today is Psalm 140, verses 5 through 13. It can be found in the church bulletin. We'll read it responsively, and I'll begin. The arrogant have hidden a trap for me, and with cords they have spread a net along the road. They have set snares for me. O Lord, my Lord, my strong deliverer, you have covered my head in the day of battle. Those who surround me lift up their heads. Let the mischief of their lips overwhelm them. Do not let the slanderer be established in the land. Let evil speedily hunt down the violent. Surely the righteous shall give thanks to your name. The upright shall live in your presence.
Our New Testament lesson this morning comes from Luke chapter 12, verses 16 through 21. Then he told them a parable. The land of a rich man produced abundantly, and he thought to himself, "What should I do? For I have no place to store my crops." Then he said, "I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build larger ones, and there I will store all my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, 'Soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, be merry.' But God said to him, 'You fool, this very night your life is being demanded of you, and the things you have prepared, whose will they be?' So it is with those who store up treasures for themselves, but are not rich toward God. Let us pray. Lord, please let your words as spoken and words as heard land in our hearts as you would have them. Amen. In this time of our church's transition, we have heard some great sermons. I have thought a lot about the sermon we heard a few weeks ago by Reverend Cynthia Wickgire Lundquist about the new path that some seeds fell on. Those seeds fell not in the tilled ruts or the planned soil. These were seeds that fell onto a new path, one that Jesus was taking people to. And Jesus explained that some seeds would make it on this new path. You can listen to Reverend Cynthia Wickwire's sermon on our website. Then we heard the sermon called How Kingdoms Grow, and we heard that wonderful example of the backstory to Martin Luther King Jr.'s rise, how he gave credit to his father as the real father of civil rights, but his father gave credit to one before him as the father of civil rights, and so on back to seeds planted through someone in 1879. You can read that full example by Dr. Ken Hughes' sermon on our website. And who can forget the wheat and the tares sermon and letting both the wheats and the weeds grow up together? It's not our call to pull the weeds, by Reverend Amy Jellensberger. For me, participating with our church in supporting United Kenya Rising, an organization so far away in Africa, reminds me of all of these examples. Who knows what will come from seeds? How far will they spread? How much good can they do? So many seeds were planted and are still being planted to make the ministry there in Kakamega, Kenya thrive. The mission started small, feeding orphans on the street, keeping children in school as much as they could. And today it's a storehouse, serving its community as a beacon of light and an example of God's love. United Kenya Rising, or UKR as it's called, employs 35 people, people who otherwise would not have a job. Serves over 200 families in their county and the surrounding counties, and it has maintained the school life for countless children, now many graduating from college and trade schools, seeds that will plant more seeds and build more storehouses. UKR's mission? To assist families and students as they rise out of poverty. Sharing support with the people of Kakamega also reminds me of Joseph's story. Our scripture today comes from Genesis 45, verse 11, when Joseph asks his brothers to say to his father, "I will provide for you there, since there are 5 more years of famine to come, so that you and your household and all that you have will not come to poverty or become destitute." God cares about poverty. In fact, sojo.net lists more than 2,000 verses in Scripture, Old and New Testament, on poverty and justice. Take care of the poor is a consistent theme. We all know the story of Joseph. We often think of it as a story of reconciliation and forgiveness, and it is. But it is striking to me that it is also a story of how God kept people from becoming impoverished. You remember the story of how Joseph's 11 brothers sold him into slavery in Egypt. They were jealous of him. They hated him. He got more attention from his father. The famous quote from Genesis 50, verse 20, comes from this story. "You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives." Joseph became the chief treasurer of all of Pharaoh's wealth. The storehouses Joseph built during his time in Egypt really struck me. They would become storehouses not just for Joseph and his family, and I don't think Joseph was even aware of this in his journey. The story goes on to say that all of Egypt came to Joseph and benefited from his storehouses. And then the whole world ended up coming to Joseph. Chapter 41, verse 57 says, "And all the countries came to Egypt to buy grain from Joseph because the famine was severe in all the world." Joseph, as a symbol of Jesus. This was my third trip to Kakamega, and so much there is changing. This time, our trip began with a three-night stay on the beautiful East African coast of Kenya at the beaches south of Mombasa. You can picture them on the Indian Ocean's warm, light blue waters and the yellow and orange, hazy, sun-filled skies. These beautiful days in sort of luxury, Kenyan style. Still plenty of bugs coming in and out of the house and not always sure if the water's gonna work. But this beautiful beginning came into sharp contrast, much like Joseph's luxury in Egypt, to the ensuing famine years, as we left there and continued our journey to western Kenya, all the way to the other side of Kenya, 10 hours, to the rapidly developing town called Kakamega. 5 years ago, on my first trip there, this was primarily a village of dirt roads. But now Kakamega is a fast-growing town, complete with paved roads, more cars, piki-pikis, or motorcycles, which is the main mode of transportation. And in fact, plans are in the works to get their own airstrip. And soon we'll be able to fly directly from Nairobi to Kakamega, which is like here to New York City. And still, so much poverty exists in a culture of subsistence living. Dirt roads still make up all the areas of rural farmlands. Food is not always plentiful and dependent on the rainy season. I saw so many tilled fields waiting for the rains to come so they could plant. But the rains weren't coming. It is foreign to be in an environment of subsistence living. People eat what they grow, wear what is on their backs. There are not closets full of clothes. There are no closets, no dressers. And not very often is there a mattress. But people are happy, and they live well, as long as they have food and shelter and the love of the people around them. All the day's work is done for the day's living. It's a fragile system when you are in a culture of subsistence. Anything can set off the balance. Becoming widowed, losing a job, a robbery, the stakes are so much higher. A famine hits so much harder. The line between destitution and well-being is much closer. But sometimes it is not easy to accept help, especially when you have felt guilty about what might have gotten you into this position in the first place. Imagine Joseph's brothers. They had done Joseph so wrong. They were so humbled and speechless when they came to buy their rations and provisions. And when they realized it was Joseph, when he revealed himself to them, imagine. Imagine Joseph in that image of such intimacy and caring, throwing his arms around the neck of Benjamin and his brothers and his father and hugging them and weeping hard, happy to help, not blaming. I'd like to tell one story from Kakamega. We visited so many homes. I remember being in the home of a man, and I think his name was Simon. He invited us to sit at his simple four-legged wooden table in one of his two mud rooms. The floor is hard-packed dirt. He was proud to seat us at a table with chairs. It was the only furniture I observed anywhere in the area. Two of his girls were in school, but the littlest was in mom's arms, looking on with awe as we talked. It had not been easy for Simon to accept help at first. His family had been doing all right. He found day labor, building clay bricks for a day, cutting wood, hauling water from the river, but lately he couldn't find day labor. And a previous incident had upset the balance of his life. He had once had chickens and a chicken coop and a sort of a whole barnyard and a goat, but thieves had come in the night and stolen his goat and chickens. And he was embarrassed about this because he had not had his coops locked up or close enough to the house to help prevent robbery. He owned about an acre or two of land in the midst of many acres that were owned and farmed by others. It was a long walk to his house, and it was sort of like in the middle of nowhere. I mean, who would be robbing? He and his wife were industrious. They plowed by hand their fields and were waiting to plant. They were trying to start over a small chicken business, but now everything was escalating. He needed help. I sat at his table and listened through the translator at how grateful he was to have received another goat and chickens and agricultural support so he could rebuild and take care of his own family. And he also talked about how during this time he had had no ideas, no thoughts for his future. He couldn't say it, but the freeze and dormancy that poverty puts you in, depression, had had a hold on him. But now it had lifted and he could dream again. He said, now his mind was reimagining more ways to prosper and with his wife and with his family. With the financial support and guidance from United Kenya Rising, he was able to rebuild the coops and the goat house, mostly made out of wood that he had collected himself. He put locks on them, and they were close to his two-room house now. He expressed how grateful he was to have his life back and his family's life. He was proud to tell about what he was doing. On the way back to the UKR offices that day, squished in the small compact car, five of us, two Americans, three Kenyans, un-air-conditioned car, windows open, the heat and the dirt kicking up from the road is blowing into the car. A Kenyan social worker on either side of me. I listened in their British English closely as they continued to talk about what a changed man Simon was. Their excitement and enthusiasm with him and for him, for how helped he was so moving. They were so moved, so glad the mamas on the board had referred this family to the organization. Their talk got to me emotionally more than even the visit. The love and passion they expressed and showed reminded me of Joseph. Joseph, who threw his arms around the neck of his brothers, and hugged them hard and wept hard. People serving others, sharing their storehouses, not blaming, brings intense emotion and joy. Our church does so much with our storehouses. We do what God puts in front of us to do, and we plant where God tells us to plant, and we listen to the Spirit, and some things land and grow. Like Joseph, who became the treasurer for all of Pharaoh's wealth, building storehouses, saving, the rest is up to God. We are a part of some great things here at Clarence Prez, things bigger than any one of us. We have so much to share. And we are loving each other in big and small ways each and every day, making ourselves vulnerable and available to each other and to others inside and outside of the church, loving each other and living in community and planting seeds. Kakamega, Kenya is one of those stories. Who knows what stories and storehouses are to come in the future? May we never be like the person in the Gospel of Luke who built his storehouses just for himself. Whatever God puts in front of us to do for the planting of love and justice, we must do. Amen. We're going to sing hymn 301, Let Us Build a House. Remain standing as we confess together. We believe that God has created the world of space and time to be the sphere of his dealings with humankind in its beauty and vastness, sublimity and awfulness, order and disorder. The world reflects to the eye of faith the majesty and mystery of its creator. We believe that God has created us for personal relationship in which we may respond to the love of the Creator. Life is a gift to be received with gratitude and a task to be pursued with courage. You may be seated. Let us pray. Dear Lord of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph, the God of all nations and people, we pray for your children across the whole earth, of every land and every race, that they may be strong to do your will. We pray especially for the church in the world, that your light would shine brighter than all the darkness of disunity, human sin, and pride. We think of countries like Ukraine and Sudan. Lord, have mercy. Please be with those who are hungry or have no place to sleep. Thank you for the work of our Buffalo City Mission and the work of United Kenya Rising, linked in causes to serve the underserved. Lord, we pray for our church family today that your spirit would continue to move us and guide us to bring comfort to a hurting world. And we pray for ourselves, Lord, for our personal hurts, losses, and pains. Lord, be with each one of us today. And Lord, we ask for your mercy. Together now, let us say the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom. Deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let us receive our morning offering.
With grateful hearts, we take time to give back to the Lord.
Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. And in my hour of darkness, she is standing right in front of me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. Let it be, let it be, let it be. whisper words of wisdom, let it be. And when the broken-hearted people living in the world agree, there will be an answer, let it be. For though they may be parted, there is still a chance that they will see. There will be an answer, let it be. 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 Yeah, let it be. Whisper words of wisdom. Let it be. And when the night is cloudy, there is still a light that shines on me. Shine until tomorrow, let it be. I wake up to the sound of music. Mother Mary comes to me. There will be an answer, let it be. Let it be, let it be, let it be, yeah, let it be. There will be an answer, let it be. Wisdom, let it be.
Thank you.
I see the stars. I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee.
Sings my soul.